The year 1979 is a huge year for the Middle East. Many of the names, ideas, wars, and governments that you have heard of over the years are in one way or another connected to 1979. Within this year, you would see the rise of new ideas and governments. You would see regional and world powers and ideas be toppled, openly challenged, or be forged in fire. You would see fear end up ruling foreign policy, and how freedom fighters of the 70s and 80s and 90s became the terrorists of the early 2000s. The Iranian Revolution is one of the most important events of the year 1979. This event would shape Middle Eastern politics up until the modern day. Hell, most of the changes I'll be talking about will be affected by this one event. Now, I'm not really going to dive into all the tiny details and infighting that caused the Iranian Revolution, but all you need to know is that the elected Prime Minister Mohammad Mossadegh would nationalize Iranian oil. Due to this, Western countries, mostly Britain and the US, feared that the Iranian Prime Minister, Mohammad Mossadegh, was about to go full-blown communist red. So a CIA and MI6-backed coup was kicked off against Mohammad Mossadegh. He was kicked out of power, and a new person in was the Shah. The Shah would do a bunch of unpopular political decisions, like establishing the CIA-backed secret police called the Savak that targeted political dissidents. And as time went on, people began to feel that the Iranian government was becoming too corrupt. On top of that, most of all of his political foes just saw him as a Western puppet. Due to the stated reasons, disillusionment with the Shah and his government became pretty ripe, but it didn't bubble over until 1978. Where a newspaper article insulting the popular religious and opposition figure Ayatollah Khomeini would be released. This would be the straw that broke the camel's back, pun intended. Supporters of Khomeini would protest this newspaper article, and let's just say the government response was a little bit over the top. The death of these protesters would kick off more protests across the country, culminating in events like the Cinema Rex fire and the Black Friday event. No, not that one. I mean the one where hundreds of protesters were shot and killed by the Iranian army. This is seen as a huge turning point in the Iranian Revolution because the Shah had to go, no matter who or what would come after him. And before you knew it, bada boom, bada bing, bada ping, bada pow, hey look, the Shah is out, and the new guy in is Ayatollah Khomeini.
It's Brittany, bitch. And I am back in the form of a new company, the Michael Scott Paper Company.
Ayatollah Khomeini during the Iranian Revolution became the de facto face of the revolution. And when Khomeini returned to Iran, him and his political allies would begin to work on what I'll be calling the second stage of the revolution, which I'll be calling the consolidation of the revolution, due to the fact that in the following years, political infighting and purges among the many revolutionary groups would begin. One of the major revolutionary factions would be Ayatollah Khomeini's faction that would work on establishing an Islamic Republic within Iran, with him and later on whoever the supreme leader would be at the head of it. And after a referendum, Iran became an Islamic Republic, but some political groups did abstain from voting. Now, some people think that the Iranian Revolution was just some massive Islamist uprising within Iran led by the mullahs. It wasn't. Different groups and different ideologies all disliked the Shah for one thing or another. And when the Shah was still in power, most of these groups were united against toppling the Shah. But now that the Shah was gone, these groups would begin to fight among each other over what should Iran be. This would lead to a whole bunch of political chaos and instability within Iran. Within the north and within the south, you began to see the rise of separatist movements and autonomy movements. I don't know what you call groups of armed men calling for autonomy but not for independence from the state, so I just call them autonomy movements. And while in the major cities of Iran, you had constitutionalists, communists, different forms of Islamists, and other political groups fighting among each other in the streets. Ayatollah Khomeini's Islamists were just the ones that were able to make it to the top of the leaderboard and were able to establish Iran as an Islamic Republic, led by Valiati Fik. Now, during the political chaos of Iran, Ayatollah Khomeini's supporters would storm the US embassy. Now, whether or not the storming was planned is up to debate. But at the end of the day, Khomeini did give the students his blessings. This action was motivated by the fact that the Shah was in the US for medical treatment because he was suffering from cancer. The Iranian government really didn't care, and they were demanding the return of the Shah so they could put him on trial and most likely put him in front of a firing squad. This event would be dubbed the Iranian hostage crisis, and in my opinion, it didn't just damage, but it would kill Iranian-American political relationships for years to come. As the 80s began to see light, Ayatollah Khomeini would begin to consolidate his power with things like establishing the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps. He'd also begin or continue, depending on which group you're in, to purge more opposition groups, including more communists, more Shah loyalists, constitutionalists, other Islamists, and other political dissidents. Khomeini's faction would actually prevent a coup called the Nojed coup plot, which was planned to overthrow the newly established Islamic Republic of Iran. Khomeini would also try to export his Islamic Revolution trademarked across the Muslim world. Hey, is that trademarked yet? He'll mostly do this by taking aim at the monarchies and the Arab republics across the Middle East, calling for their overthrow. This would, shockingly, alienate Iran from most of its neighbors due to the whole "the revolution never dies" thing. Iran would also alienate themselves from the superpowers by angering them one way or another. The Americans with the Iranian hostage crisis, and the Soviets by purging communist groups. Consolidation of power is why Iran is still led by Khomeini's ideal government, Valiati Fik. Now, I do apologize to any Iranian viewers if I'm oversimplifying some things. I feel like the Iranian Revolution, before, during, and after, could be videos on their own, and this is just a quick summary. Now, during this revolutionary fervor, Iran would try to export its Islamic Revolution, trademarked, to the Muslim world, still not trademarked, with Khomeini calling for the overthrow of monarchies and republics and that he felt were going against the will of the people. Ayatollah Khomeini also didn't have no problem with some pan-Islamism around the world. Iran would support groups within Afghanistan, Lebanon, and Iraq. Iran would also support the Palestinian cause, praising Yasser Arafat in denouncing the 1979 Egypt-Israel peace treaty. Iran's whole exportation of the revolution would go against almost everybody's interests within the Middle East, as Iran was talking about massive regional changes going against the status quo in some areas. This would lead to most of the Middle Eastern states, the USSR, and the US to become very concerned with Iran's exportation of the revolution. This would cause bad blood between Iran and states that Iran felt were illegitimate or were oppressing their people. Following the Iranian Revolution, Iran would claim Bahrain as a part of Iran. And in 1981, a Shia Islamist coup was thwarted by the Sunni Bahraini government, that the group was most likely inspired by the Iranian Revolution. The group would later lead a bombing campaign in the 90s against the Bahraini government. And let's just say that might have hurt Bahraini-Iranian political relationships for a while. Well, in 1983, Kuwait would suffer a massive organized bombing attack targeting foreign embassies and government centers within Kuwait City. I mean, this was a huge bombing plot, and it's only a miracle that 5 people were killed. This attack is highly suspected to be committed by Shia Islamists. A little bit up north from Kuwait is Iraq, a country that has a Shia Arab majority but had mostly been under the rule of the Sunni Arab minority since the Kingdom of Iraq. And as time went on, especially during the Ba'athist rule, discrimination and oppression against Shias would increase, and when the Iranian Revolution kicked off in the the Shia-majority neighboring Iran, many Shiite Islamist dissidents became pretty riled up too and would begin to lead campaigns against Saddam Hussein, with some picking up guns and taking aim. This of course concerned Saddam, and he would begin to work on cracking down on Shiite Islamists and political dissidents. From the Iranian point of view, Iran had no problem supporting these groups as they felt that the Iraqi government was oppressing the majority Shia Muslims and had every right to be overthrown. From the Iraqi point of view, these Iranian-backed groups and Saddam's future plan for Iran would help set up both of these states for a huge clash later down the line. Iran will help many Shiite Iraqi dissidents with the formation of the Supreme Council for the Islamic Revolution in Iran. And let me state now, that group was formed during the Iran-Iraq War. The group would be heavily funded and supported by Iran, and would later partake in popular revolts against Saddam Hussein's government. The group still exists today for anyone wondering, and participate in Iraqi politics. Now let's move to Lebanon, which has been in a civil war since 1975, a civil war that pitted the PLO, the Lebanese leftists, and Lebanese Muslims against Lebanese right-wingers and the Mani-right Christians. Heck, even a Syrian intervention in 1976 would kick off, but they switched sides, so they'll have their own color on the map. PLO would base themselves in South Lebanon and would begin to conduct attacks into Israel, leading up to the Coastal Road Massacre, which would cause Operation Laton, where the IDF would move into South to attack the PLO. They would only pull out after UN pressure, but not without setting up a security zone and supplying and supporting the South Lebanese army. Israel would find itself in South Lebanon multiple times as the civil war continued, and later on with Hezbollah. The Israelis, or what Kanye West would call them, Israelians, would find themselves fighting the PLO, Lebanese factions, and sometimes the Syrian, like in the 1982 Lebanon War. As the 1982 war continued, one of the many groups that would form to counter Israel would be Hezbollah, that was helped form by Iran in 1985 in an attempt to export its Islamic revolution. Hezbollah and other factions would lead, or for some continue, the guerrilla war against Israel and the SLA forces in the South Lebanese conflict. The Israelis would later pull out of South Lebanon in 2000, and the SLA would collapse and die. Hezbollah would proclaim this as a victory over Israel, and Hezbollah would become a massive political party in Lebanon with guns. Hezbollah was doing that whole guerrilla warfare stuff. The Lebanese civil war ended with most of their groups disarming and granting each other amnesty. As of today, Hezbollah and Israel still have a, let's just say, tense relationship, with them having a whole war in 2006. Hezbollah is still here today and is seen as a Iranian ally using the greater Iranian-Israeli, let's just say, staring competition. So why does this matter? Well, people tend to think that only Saudi Arabia is exporting Islamism across the Middle East, rightfully so. But people tend to overlook that Iran is doing the same thing. If you couldn't tell, many of the modern Middle Eastern conflicts that we see today tend to have Iranian backing, and in some cases have Iranian-backed Islamist groups, either from the border towns of Lebanon to the city blocks of, now the fields of Syria, and to the bustling neighborhoods of Basra. Iran's exportation of its Islamic revolution is pretty wide in the Middle East. It just took a lot of time. Man, if people think I'm a Saudi shell, then here comes the next part. Saudi Arabia, a monarchy led by the Saudi family. It's in the name. The Saudi family would ally with, at one time, the Wahhabi clergy, that I'll be calling the ulama. They would work together to conquer the Arabian Peninsula, and they were pretty good at it. The ulama and the monarchy would have a pretty solid relationship between each other, excluding the totally not foreshadowing Ikhwan Revolt. And for those that don't know what the Ikhwan Revolt was a revolt led by mostly hardline Wahhabis that felt that Ibn Saud was being too lenient towards the British. They felt that they could still continue raiding into Kuwait and into Iraq, which was owned by the British at the time. Ibn Saud did not support these raids, and as time went on, the Ikhwan would begin to undermine Ibn Saud's authority, which was, don't do these raids. Ibn Saud, surprisingly, did not like this, and this would lead to a clash, aka the Ikhwan Revolt. And when I say foreshadowing, I mean unbelievable amounts of foreshadowing. This buddy-buddy relationship between the two would be there until the oil boom and the rule of King Faisal. King Faisal would begin to work on modernizing the nation of Saudi Arabia, from things like banning slavery, allowing women to learn, and opening the first TV station in Saudi Arabia. His steps towards modernization would face backlash from more conservative corners of Saudi Arabia, and would actually lead to the death of his half-brother Khalid bin Masudi. Khalid ibn Masudi would be killed after being in a shootout with Saudi police while protesting King Faisal's modernization attempts. King Faisal also participated in the Arab Cold War, and he was known for his Islamic views on diplomacy, but that's a whole new video for another day that I will probably do later down the line. King Faisal would ironically be assassinated by his half-brother's half-brother, Faisal ibn Masud. His successor, King Khalid ibn Abdulaziz, with the help of later King Fahd, would also continue modernizing the nation of Saudi Arabia. This would continue to cause more conservative and later on more extreme citizens to become disillusioned with the kingdom, as they felt that the modernization attempts were going too far and too un-Islamic. One dude who was super disillusioned would be Juhayman ibn Muhammad and later on his followers. Juhayman felt that the Saudi attempts of modernization was causing the kingdom to lose its Islamic identity. Juhayman would later lead a grassroots movement against the Saudi kingdom, and he actually got arrested over it, but was later released at the request of Bin Baz. Juhayman's grassroots movement was known for publicly criticizing the Saudi kingdom and its attempts towards modernization. As time went on, this group would become a tiny thorn against the Saudi government, but the group did start off non-violently. As time went on, the group would begin to adopt more militant aims against Saudi Arabia and its modernization. On the morning of 20th of November, 1979, during early Fajr prayers, a group of 300 to 600 armed fighters would storm the Masjid al-Haram, closing the gates and locking down the masjid. Now, during the initial storming of the masjid, nobody knew who actually did it. The US believed that the attack was being committed by Iranian-inspired gunmen, while the Iranian government would claim that the US was behind the attack. Unknown to anybody at the early stages of the storming was that the group was led by hardline Sunni extremists. The group was Juhayman's group, and they would proclaim one of their leaders, Muhammad bin Abdul al-Qattani, who I'll be calling Muhammad Qattani, to be the Mahdi. Now, for those who don't know who the Mahdi is seen as a uniting and a redeeming figure of Islam. He is also seen as one of the last minor signs towards Judgment Day in Islamic theology. Other than falsely claiming to be the Mahdi, which is a hill I'm willing to die on, him and his followers would also damn the royal family and also the ulama, thinking that they're too lenient in losing their Islamic identity, which I personally think is one of the more leading factors for most of the men. Now, one thing you guys need to know is that Juhayman ibn Muhammad was the head of the whole operation. He was the guy that convinced Muhammad Qattani that he was the Mahdi. He would help organize the operation, and he would continue to gain supporters all the way up into the storming.
I myself is Imam Mahdi, and I am giving you the good news of the arrival.
Where they would hold out against Saudi troops and Pakistani special forces and the GIGN. Well, depending on which source you have, I've heard so many rumors about them. The militants would turn the minarets into sniper posts, and every door into the masjid was turned into a literal funnel of death. On top of that, the underground labyrinth of the masjid was turned into a maze full of armed zealots and traps, in the dark, to make things spooky. The only way the militant morale would break is when the militants were pushed into said labyrinth and the supposed Mahdi was blown up by a hand grenade. He had a habit of playing hot potato with the grenades and tossing them back, but when Saudi forces learned how to cook their grenades, his legs were promptly blown off. The death of the Mahdi, air quotes, and tear gas being pumped into the labyrinth non-stop would break the morale of the remaining militants. By the end of the attack, most of the leaders and fighters were publicly beheaded. To be honest, this whole conflict is something interesting, and I plan to make a video on it, hopefully in the not-so-distant future, which we all know means in like 7 months. At the time of the Grand Mosque seizure, the oil-rich but mostly Shiite-dominated region of Qatif would begin to have its own uprising against the Saudi family, mostly aimed at the discrimination that Shiites were facing from the Saudi Wahhabi kingdom. For those that don't know, Wahhabis tend to have a very rocky relationship with Shiites, especially in this area. The uprising would begin following Shiite Muslims celebrating the Shiite holy day of Ashura, which was banned. This action of defiance towards the Saudi kingdom would cause other Shiite areas to begin to protest and hold their own rallies. The Saudi National Guard would be called in to quell these protests and rallies, and well, things happen. The military presence would lead to clashes between protesters and government troops. And well, the usual things happen when you have an increased military force and, well, mad protesters. Good old classic rock tossing would begin. The National Guard would respond to this rock tossing by shooting and killing protesters. This action would cause more violent clashes to commence between Shiite protesters and the Saudi troops, with it only ending on December 3rd, a day before Juhayman surrendered. Following this uprising, the Saudi state would have to reevaluate their stance on Qatif. They would begin to work on fixing the region, but just placing buildings didn't solve the problem overnight. 1979 and these two uprisings were a pretty big shocker to the Saudi kingdom, as it showed that the monarchy wasn't invincible. The Iranian Revolution affected the kingdom with the Shiites uprising in the Qatif. The echo of the Qatif conflict is still felt today. While the conflict might be a low-level conflict, it still has sparked international events like the death of Imam al-Nimr al-Nimr, and there's still clashes like at the Battle of This Place I Won't Even Try to Butcher. While the Kaaba siege showed that Sunni extremists would still attack the Saudi kingdom if they felt the kingdom was losing itself to non-Muslims or un-Islamic entities. This shocker would shake the Saudi kingdom and would lead to the kingdom rolling back on its modernization attempts. Political dissidents were then crushed, and in an attempt to gain respect from the conservative corners of Saudi Arabia again, Saudi Arabia would begin to export Wahhabism back into Saudi Arabia and into the Muslim world. This action would have two things happen. One, when Saudi Arabia began to support jihadist groups across the Middle East, it caused a split between the whole Islamist political scene in the Middle East. Like I stated before, Iran was known for exporting Islamism in the Middle East, but when Saudi Arabia began to do it too, a split began in Islamism politics. Within this split, you'd see Iranian-backed or more Iranian-minded Islamist groups come into conflict with more Saudi-backed or more Saudi-minded or Qutubi-minded or Salafi-minded or Wahhabi-minded, which would probably be more Saudi-minded. But you guys know what I'm trying to say. These groups did not like these groups, and because they didn't like each other, conflict was going to arise between these groups. And in some cases, these groups would go AWOL and would say screw you to both groups. And number two, a thing that can't be denied is due to Saudi Arabia exporting and supporting Wahhabi and, to be honest, any jihadist group in the Middle East at the time, which was used to counter Iranian but mostly Soviet influence, would intentionally or unintentionally help form a breeding ground of recruitment for groups like Al-Qaeda and for people like Osama bin Laden. And well, we all know what those guys did. Now, let's see what's the next country on our list. Yikes, just yikes. This whole section, yikes, but god damn it, it did happen in 1979. So here goes half of my subscribers. The Arab-Israeli conflict would officially start in 1948, where the neighboring Arab states of Syria, Jordan, and Egypt would show up to support Palestinians in a war against Israelis. And to the surprise of everybody on this map, the Israelis would win and would establish the State of Israel. This would lead to a series of conflict between Israel and its Arab neighbors, and by 1967, the map of Israel after the Six-Day War would look about this big. Talk about a chunky Israel. Seeing how bad Israel body slammed their neighbors in just 6 days, members of the Arab League would attend the 1967 Arab League Summit. The summit would see the creation of the Khartoum Resolution, aka the Three No's. The Three No's were a form of forcing Israel out of Middle Eastern and Arab politics. This was done by having no negotiations with Israel, no peace treaties with Israel, and no recognition of Israel, along with the insistence on Palestinian rights within their own nation. You could define your own nations as you may. The Three No's and the insistence of Palestinian rights would become the policy under Egypt with Gamal Abdel Nasser, where he'd kick off the war of attrition over the Sinai Peninsula between Egypt and Israel. On the Israeli side of the border, Jewish settlements would begin to be formed within the Sinai, the Gaza, and the West Bank, with Palestinians and Arabs in the area being expelled to neighboring Arab nations, which totally didn't come back to bite Israel in the butt, right? Even after the death of Gamal Abdel Nasser, the next leader of Egypt, Anwar Sadat, would continue the policy of the Three No's. And by 1973, a new war would break out, the Yom Kippur War, aka the Ramadan War, aka the October War. Within this war, Egypt and Syria and later expeditionary forces from these countries would go to war with Israel to gain control of the Sinai Peninsula in the Golan Heights. The war would end up in a Israeli tactical victory, but the 1973 oil embargo would lead to peace talks and the end of the war. Following the Yamadan October War, which is what I will be calling it now, Egyptian President Anwar Sadat would visit Israel in 1977 in the hopes of opening negotiations between Egypt and Israel. Intense negotiations would begin, and to the surprise of everybody, both sides would come up with a solution with the help of the US. This solution would be called, you might have heard of it, the Camp David Accord. The Camp David Accord would later become the foundation for the Egyptian-Israeli peace treaty signed in 1979. Within this treaty, Egypt would recognize Israel, the two states would normalize relationships between each other, both sides would end hostilities, the Sinai would see demilitarization, and Israel would return the Sinai Peninsula to Egypt. Now, if you couldn't tell, this goes against everything within the three no's. No peace treaties with Israel, no recognition with Israel, and no negotiations with Israel. This action would both have Egyptian President Anwar Sadat and Israeli Prime Minister Menachem Begin win a Nobel Peace Prize, but they would also face major backlash from their own base. Menachem Begin would see backlash when he had to force out Israeli settlers within the Sinai. While on the Egyptian side, Syria and the PLO would denounce Anwar Sadat, as they felt that the treaty was made without thinking about the Palestinians in occupied territories or in the refugee camps in the neighboring Arab states. Egypt would also get kicked out of the Arab League until 1989, but unlike the Israeli Prime Minister Menachem Begin, Egyptian President Anwar Sadat would be killed in 1981 by the Egyptian Islamic Jihad group over this treaty. These groups really need better names. But even with the death of Anwar Sadat, the peace treaty would still hold out until today, which is my segue to the modern Arab-Israeli conflict, the one that scares me the most. Oh God, why? Disclaimer now, I will be oversimplifying a lot of stuff starting now. Do your own research, please. Don't use a YouTube video as just your one getup. A good amount of nations or factions that were once at war with Israel now have peace treaties with it, with them being Egypt, Jordan, and the PLO. This is why the Arab-Israeli conflict has died down between nation-states like Egypt and Israel since the Yamadan October War. This doesn't mean that the Arab-Israeli conflict is dead. The Israeli-Palestinian, or the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, is still ongoing, and while there has been steps towards peace like the Oslo Accord between the PA and Israel, recent flare-ups and questions in the conflicts like the Intifadas, Hamas, the blockade on Gaza, and the issue of illegal Israeli settlements in the West Bank has shown us that the conflict is still ongoing and has fuel. But the days of seeing massive Arab and Israeli armies have died down recently due to the previous stated reasons and that peace treaty. Now, I'm not saying those days are over, as I can't predict the future and who knows what could happen, but the current Arab-Israeli conflict has mostly become one between Israel and armed groups, instead of Israel and other neighbors. Thank God I'm finally out of that section. I feel like I already angered three people. Now let's look at the list. The next country on our list of countries is Iraq. Wait, is it Iraq? Yo, how do I pronounce this country correctly? Iraq, officially created in 1920, would become one of the most important countries in Middle Eastern history and politics, and also before it was officially created, but this is more in a modern sense. Iraq would start off as a kingdom led by the Hashemite dynasty in 1932. It also had a weird World War II subplot in 1942, but that really went nowhere. And after that subplot, the monarchy continued to rule Iraq until 1958, where they'd be overthrown and killed by Abd al-Karim Qassam in the July 14th Revolution. The new and improved Republic of Iraq would quickly find itself between a rock and a hard place, mostly between the Iraqi nationalists and the Iraqi communists. The Republic would then face another coup in 1963 with the Ramadan Revolution led by Ba'athists and Arab nationalists. They were led by Ahmed Hassan al-Bakr, who became the president of Iraq. Now, to oversimplify Saddam's rise to power in Iraq, Saddam was able to make a name for himself behind the scenes in Iraqi politics, basically becoming the de facto leader. Until 1979, where the current president, Ahmed Hassan al-Bakr, would step down due to health problems. That some say Saddam had a pretty big say in how sick he felt. Saddam would stop being the de facto president and would end up becoming the official president of Iraq in 1979, on July 16th. Saddam, right off the bat, would begin to purge his political foes, starting off with the 1979 Ba'athist Party purge, where he would convene an assembly of Ba'ath Party members and leaders, and he would claim that a Syrian-backed coup was in the works to unite Iraq with Syria, led by Hafez al-Assad. Saddam Hussein would then have Abdul Hassan read out a list of collaborators with him within the coup. Some people say he only did this after being tortured. Saddam Hussein would then sit back and puff away from his cigars as panic would fill the room as people were snatched up by troops and bodyguards alike, one by one. And if you think I'm being dramatic and I'm making this up for effect and all that in the video, I am not. Saddam Hussein literally filmed the purge. I'm showing you footage as it happens right now. Following the end of that whole purge thing, Saddam Hussein would thank those left in the room for their loyalty towards Iraq. While those picked for being a collaborator were put on trial and 22 of them would be executed. Now that is some big Saddam energy if I've ever seen some. Within the same year that Saddam Hussein came to power, the Iranian Revolution also happened. This would give rise to one of Iraq's biggest foes. Now even before Saddam became the official president of Iraq, he was already working on taking over the vastly important Shatt al-Arab and Ahwaz region from Iran. The Iranian Revolution and its political collapse would ramp up Saddam's interest from a 7 out of 10 to a 12 out of 10. Saddam Hussein would lead an Iraqi army into Iran, and this would kick off the Iran-Iraq War. The Iran-Iraq War was an 8-year brutal war where trench-like tactics were used with modern weapons. Well, moderner weapons. It was practically World War I with a Cold War setting.
Our final victory in the field.
Would this brilliant plan involve us climbing out of our trenches and walking very slowly towards the enemy, sir?
How could you possibly know that, Blackadder? It's classified information.
Now, during the Iran-Iraq War, Iran would find itself fighting off not just Iraq, but practically the whole wide world. The USSR, the US, the French, and many other states would support Iraq against Iran as they felt that Iran was a huge anti-status quo power of the region, which didn't sway towards communism, but also weren't pro-Western. But that didn't stop some sides from supporting both sides, right? Now remember the whole consolidation of the revolution part earlier in the video? Well, during the Iran-Iraq War, the Iranian government was able to purge even more political enemies due to the war effort. Now I do feel like I must state that during the Iran-Iraq War, there were some political foes that did take up arms against the Iranian government, like the PMOI or the MKO, or what I like to call them, the Mech Group. And no, they did not have mechs. Now for those that don't know, which I think is the vast majority of Western audiences, the Mech Group led a bombing campaign against the Iranian government and would later on lead a full-scale invasion into Iran with Iraqi help. That invasion failed, if you couldn't tell. The Iran-Iraq War would end with no decisive winner, but don't tell that to everyone. Some people think one side won. Iran and Iraq would find their economies ravaged by this war, and Iraq would find itself having to repay the debt that it accumulated from states that loaned them support. Saddam would not pay off these debts as he was kind of broke due to the whole war thing, and would later begin to accuse Kuwait of side drilling into Iraqi land. Saddam also claimed that Kuwait was going against OPEC oil regulations that Saddam felt was screwing over the Iraqi economy. This surprisingly didn't go well for Kuwait, and Saddam would invade Kuwait on historical claims. Seeing how this huge battle-hardened Iraqi army was on their border, Saudi Arabia would begin to look for help. One person that showed up to help Saudi Arabia would actually be Osama bin Laden, who said that he'd be able to rise an army of Mujahideen to take back Kuwait. The Saudi kingdom most likely reacted to Osama bin Laden like this. Wait, bin Laden's son wants to take on one of the world's biggest armies that just got supplied by Western powers for a whole 8 years? Can't we just ask the Americans to do this or something? The US would respond to this by forming a coalition and kicking off the first Persian Gulf War. Or a second one if you think the Iran-Iraq War was a Persian Gulf War. The first Persian Gulf War, the one with American soldiers, would end with a swift coalition victory. Iraq would then be placed under sanctions, a no-fly zone would be established, and Iraq would become a foe against the US in the Middle East. Excluding when it came to Iran, Iran was like the big boogeyman. While tanks were blowing each other up in the deserts of Kuwait, mostly American tanks blowing up Iraqi ones, Osama bin Laden would take this note from the Saudi kingdom to heart and would be disgusted at the fact that American non-Muslims were within Arabia. Osama bin Laden would then begin to feel that the Saudi kingdom was beginning to lose its Islamic identity. I feel like I heard that somewhere before. This would be one of the reasons, but not the only one, the dude had a lot of reasons, that Osama bin Laden would begin to turn his aims towards the US and towards governments that he saw as taghut. Taghut, and I stress this, used in a modern political setting, is used as a term to describe tyrannical governments. Osama bin Laden would then become a thorn in the Saudi government, where he would begin to publicly criticize the Saudi kingdom. He would later be banished from Saudi Arabia, with him moving to Sudan, where he would keep on working on his Al-Qaeda group thing and would still continue to criticize the Saudi government. Osama bin Laden also began to make ties with other like-minded Islamist groups in the area, one being the Egyptian Islamic Jihad group, where they once again tried to assassinate an Egyptian president, this time Hosni Mubarak, but they failed. This event would have the Saudis, Egyptians, and the American government pressure the Sudanese government to kick out Osama bin Laden. They would. Osama bin Laden would then move to the next country on our list, funny enough. Wait, I just made a video on this! The Soviet invasion into Afghanistan and the US supplying the Mujahideen with Operation Cyclone would have rippling effects throughout the whole world. This war would see the birth of groups like Al-Qaeda and would see the rise of people like Osama bin Laden. But I already made a video on this, so I'm kind of just gonna have Revolver Ocelot explain it from Metal Gear Solid 5. My writing is never going to be as good as Hideo Kojima's, so enjoy what you're listening to, because that level of writing is never going to be on this channel.
Christmas Eve, 1979. The Soviet Union rolled into Afghanistan. Muslims had revolted against the Soviet-friendly regime established the year before. The DRA forces could no longer contain it themselves, so the Soviets went in to intervene. The Afghan government was powerless and fraught with infighting. They lost the hearts and minds of the people, and that alarmed the Soviet leadership. With the Islamic Revolution happening in Iran, the Soviets felt they had to act fast or risk the spread of Islamic revivalism. A superpower sending a motorized rifle division against men on horseback with antique rifles. Everyone thought it'd be over in an instant, only it wasn't. Some Muslims made their fight a jihad, a holy war, and began a guerrilla campaign on all fronts. A war of attrition. These fighters call themselves Mujahideen. They're being supported by the West through Pakistan. The war has become a nightmare for the Soviet troops stationed here. They thought they'd be headed home in 6 months at the most. Then a year passed. 2 years. Now here we are 4 years on with no exit in sight. Afghanistan has become the Soviet Union's Vietnam.
Now, some things that Revolver Ocelot overlooked, and to be honest, couldn't predict, was that the Soviets would pull out of Afghanistan in 1989 after fighting an 8-year brutal insurgency. Following the Soviet pullout, the PDPA government would collapse with the many Mujahideen groups. Afghanistan wouldn't see peace after that, as the many Mujahideen groups would then begin to fall into infighting among each other, and Afghanistan would find itself in a state of civil war from 1979 until, well, today. But I'm not here to talk about today right now. I mean, I am going to talk about today, but let me talk about yesterday before I get into today, which would be yesterday's tomorrow. You guys know what I'm trying to say. So let's just go back to the Soviet invasion into Afghanistan before the Soviet pullout, where the Afghan Mujahideen would gain international support from the US with things like Operation Cyclone, but they'd also get support from other Muslim nations, one being Pakistan and one being Saudi Arabia, along with many Arab volunteers. While there are many Mujahideen groups that fought against the PDPA, and some that were actually Maoist, one of the more defining images of the Mujahideen are the Arab volunteers, and they would make their way to Afghanistan, where they'd link up with Afghan Islamists too. Afghanistan would become the training ground and the birthplace for many of these jihadist groups that we hear about today, and the foreign backing they got to fight against the Soviets didn't hurt them one bit. One of these Arab Islamist volunteers would be a Saudi man you might have never heard of, Osama bin Laden. While in Afghanistan, Osama and some of his buddies would begin to work on a super duper no girls allowed bad boys club. The club mostly consisted of helping and organizing foreign volunteers before sending them off to Afghanistan. This group would be called, okay, I took like 7 years of Arabic. It was called the Maktabat al-Kidamat. I hope I didn't butcher that. After the Soviets pulled out and the PDPA government collapsed, Maktabat al-Qadama would then form into Al-Qaeda as it wanted to take a more militant role across the whole Muslim world. Osama, Buddies, and Ayman al-Zawahiri would then begin to envelop the new Al-Qaeda group into struggles and conflicts across the Muslim world, as Al-Qaeda was hyped on the idea that the Muslim world should be united or at the very least ruled by Sharia law. And also, they wanted to help Muslims that they viewed as being oppressed. This would have Al-Qaeda send fighters, aid, money, and form connections in war zones like Chechnya, Afghanistan, Tajikistan, Kashmir, and places that would make this list too long. The world's a depressing place. This is one of the reasons why Al-Qaeda today is an international group, and it isn't just some random group in some random region. In 1989, aka the same year the Soviets pulled out of Afghanistan, Osama bin Laden would make his way back home, where he would begin to work on getting more support for his Al-Qaeda group. And well, we already know how that went with the whole Saddam invading thing and him getting banished from Saudi Arabia and later Sudan. Osama bin Laden would then set up base within Afghanistan, and he would begin to help the Taliban group take massive parts of Afghanistan during the Afghan Civil War. I made a whole video about it, here it is. As the Afghan Civil War continued, Al-Qaeda became a more stronger group, and Osama bin Laden would then declare a jihad, aka a struggle, in this case an armed struggle, against the US. Osama bin Laden would then begin a series of terrorist attacks upon Americans and American interests. Al-Qaeda would begin to commit their attacks, like with the 1998 US Embassy bombing, where they would bomb US embassies in Tanzania and in Kenya. Al-Qaeda would even target American soldiers, like with the USS Cole bombing. They also had a bombing attempt, but that bombing attempt failed when the bombs were too heavy for the boat and it caused the boat to sink. And that must have been an awkward conversation with their boss. Jokes aside, Osama bin Laden would conduct one of the world's worst terrorist attacks, striking the Twin Towers, the Pentagon, and he failed to either attack the White House or the Capitol building. He would use American jetliners as suicide missiles that were piloted by Al-Qaeda hijackers. This attack would kill over 2,000 Americans and would anger the giant known as America. This would kick off the War on Terror, the invasion of Afghanistan, the invasion of Iraq, Guantanamo Bay, Abu Ghraib, your mom is, and much more colorful things I can make whole videos on. This one attack would begin one of the most defining wars of the 21st century, the War on Terror. But I'm kinda gonna cut the video at that part, because at this point I'm just going to be making a whole new video, which is practically the War on Terror, and I don't think I am mentally prepared for that yet. In conclusion, the year 1979 is a year where the current Middle East began. It's the official year where one of the leading Arab powers, Egypt, would opt out of the Arab-Israeli conflict. It's where we would see the Arab-Israeli conflict mostly become one between Palestinians and Israeli, with the conflict having its own sub-conflicts in Syria, once in a while, and in Lebanon. 1979 is the year where Iran and the US would also establish their colorful relationship between each other. Iran would begin to export its Islamic revolution and would find itself at odds with almost everybody at the time, and this would be the early stages of the Middle Eastern Cold War that people talk about today. While in the Arabian Peninsula, the fear of such an attack from extremists like Jahaman would force Saudi Arabia to not halt but to slow down its modernization attempts for a while, and in a way to dilute or to influence like-minded groups, they would end up supplying them. But in the end, they would only end up empowering them and to help drive people like Osama bin Laden. Iraq would also see change in the same year with Saddam Hussein coming into power. Saddam was able to place himself as a staunch anti-Iranian power in the Middle East, with Western and Eastern support. But his invasion into Kuwait would also find himself in the axis of evil. And following the 9/11 attack, Iraq would be invaded by the US, and the US kind of butchered the whole de-Ba'athification thing, and the forming of the new Iraqi government would indirectly open the floodgates for groups like Al-Qaeda and later on Shiite insurgencies to clash in Iraq, up until the modern day. Man, this video is depressing. How many videos have I made that are related to Islamism one way or another? I need to make a video that isn't related to Islamism. Oh yeah, today's video sponsor is bath water.
Not that bath water. But this bath water. This bath water is both Syrian and Iraqi approved. So whatever your party split is, it doesn't matter with this water. This water comes from the rivers of the Euphrates and the Tigris rivers. So it's OG bath water that you should buy today.